running back Ray Davis off a 280-yard performance last week against Florida. Tonight, a bigger challenge against the number one team in the country in front of a raucous crowd of more than 92,000. Welcome, everyone, to ESPN Saturday College Football Primetime presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. It's the Dr. Pepper Championship Drive Game of the Week. Two 5-0 teams, number 20, Kentucky, and number 1, Georgia. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough along with Greg McElroy. Delighted to have you with us for what should be a very physical football game. Greg, Mark Stoops has done a terrific job in his 11 years in Lexington. They're a consistent winner now. He says tonight a chance for a giant step for the program. Beat number 1. If they're going to do it, how is it going to happen?
Well, their stars have to play like stars, and Ray Davis, as you referenced, just a phenomenal football player. The transfer from Vanderbilt has already showcased so much speed, so much elusiveness, but a real comfort level within this offense. Very patient runner, but great acceleration when he gets vertical. But his quarterback is going to have to be better tonight. Devin Leary, so far this year, a little sporadic with his accuracy from time to time, hasn't made great decisions, hasn't always looked comfortable. And against this Georgia defense, you got to make some big plays because you just can't rely exclusively on your run game.
Georgia 5-0. The perception is perhaps this team isn't quite as good as the last two that won the national title. Kirby Smart, the coach, said usually after 5 games we know a lot about the team. He's still learning about his team. One thing he knows for sure, he has a tremendous tight end in Brock Bowers.
If the award for the Heisman Trophy is supposed to go to the most outstanding player in college football, he has to be on the short list. He's so good after the catch. Tremendous acceleration. He's obviously extremely sure-handed, and he has been tremendous for his young quarterback, Carson Beck. Last week, difficult spot, and Carson Beck looked in the direction of Brock Bowers, but my goodness, Carson Beck has grown so much over the first half of the season. He's really been the star of this offense outside of Brock Bowers because the run game has been remarkably inconsistent.
He's had back-to-back 300-yard passing games, brought them from behind last week for victory at Auburn. Georgia has won the last 13 head-to-head against the Wildcats. The opening kickoff on a gorgeous night between the hedges right after this. And this is the SEC on ESPN. From Sanford Stadium, Athens, Georgia, 69th consecutive sellout crowd on hand, hoping their team will make a championship drive for their third straight national championship. Big test tonight against a very good Kentucky team. The Wildcats won the toss. Mark Stoops deferred, so Kentucky will kick off. Chance Poor teeing it up with a pretty good breeze at his back. Temperature in the low 60s. Just a perfect night for college football. Dylan Bell and Makai Muse are back deep for Georgia. Poor ordinarily kicks touchbacks, 29 touchbacks and 34 kickoffs this year for the fifth-year senior from Anderson, South Carolina. And we're underway. Muse will not try to run it out. Here's Molly McGrath.
Well, Sean, both teams had crucial playmakers who were game-time decisions. Georgia wide receiver Ladd McConkey will play tonight. He didn't practice all week because of a lingering back injury, but he was used situationally on third downs last week. But head coach Kirby Smart told me he likes him better on first and second downs tonight, saying if he plays, I'm not going to limit him. He's going to play. Kentucky wide receivers Berrion Brown and Tavion Robinson both suffered lower body injuries in last week's game. They're both available, but Brown is not 100% healthy. We will not see him as a kick returner tonight, Sean.
Brown bothered by a hamstring. He had 10 catches against Georgia last year in Lexington. Beck comes out throwing. Dejon Edwards, some nifty maneuvering across the 30. Taken down by Keyshawn Silver in the middle of the front three. Beck, a big man, 6'4", 220, waited 3 years to become the starting quarterback, played behind Stetson Bennett. Has started all 5 this year. completing 72% of his passes, and as you saw at the outset, just under 300 yards per game. On the rollout, he's on target to Marcus Rosemead, Jack Saint. Kirby Smart told us yesterday, Greg, if Beck's had a problem, it's early in the games, perhaps a little too amped up. We saw last week he missed a wide open deep throw down the middle to Oscar Dell, but he has tended to settle in and play better as the games have gone along.
He's remarkably talented and has a great understanding of this offense, but you referenced it, maybe a little tight early, obviously not a ton of experience as a starter, but really settles into the game.
Dylan Bell lined up in the backfield, ordinarily a wide receiver. Another short throw and good run after the catch by Dominic Lovett for a 9-yard pickup for the transfer from Missouri.
This is how you get your quarterback into the game a little earlier. Just some short, high percentage completions, easy throws for Carson Beck to get him comfortable.
They're already out to their own 49. It's been a slow starting Georgia team. They've scored only 17 first quarter points in their first 5 games total. They've been dead even, 17-17 in the first quarter. And then dominant thereafter. Dylan Bell yanked down for a loss. Octavius Oxendine, the defensive end, dropped that for a loss of 2.
Great job at the end of the line of scrimmage. You see Oxendine working against Xavier Truss and Brock Bauer, splits the 2 and makes the tackle for loss.
So here's 3rd down and 3. Bell remains the running back. He goes out into the flat. Beck has room to run for the first down. Decided not to slide and got hit by De'Eric Jackson. But he got 7 on 3rd down, and Georgia continues.
Good job there by Carson Beck. Good coverage downfield from Kentucky. But they're not really worried about Carson Beck's legs. That's where this offense is very different from a year ago. Stetson Bennett was a threat to take off every single time, whereas Carson Beck really going to live in the pocket, more traditional, more prototypical. That time, clearly saw an opening and made him pay.
Dejon Edwards back in. And he breaks tackles, drives the pile. De'Eric Jackson whiffed near the line of scrimmage. And as a result, it's a 7-yard gain. To use Kirby Smart's phrase, we do not have an elite running back. They're leaning heavily on Edwards, but that's not a strength of their team this year.
And they're very thin there. Of course, moved Dylan Bell into running back as well. Obviously, he's a receiver, so they've been very thin with some attrition and some injuries that have hit that room.
Play action pass. Beck was looking deep. Throws it deep. Rosemead Jackson has the touchdown. Well, that is not a slow start.
This is the way you do it. You see Kentucky selling out against the run. Zion Childress sprints towards the line of scrimmage on the play action fake. And as a result, Carson Beck's able to drop it right over the top to Rosemead Jackson in stride. And what a start for the Georgia Bulldogs.
Right down the field in 7 plays. Beck was 4 for 4 for 64 on the drive and the touchdown of 40 yards to the senior from Pompano Beach, Florida, Marcus Rosemead Jackson, his 2nd touchdown of the year. The true freshman Peyton Woodring on for the extra point. Right down the middle. Wide open was Rosemead Jackson. 7-0 Georgia. And long student sections across the country are competing to be the Taco Bell LIFMA student section of the year. Download the Taco Bell app to learn more. Student section here in Athens fully engaged early. A quick score for Georgia. In contrast to their first 2 conference games, they trailed South Carolina here 14-3 at the half. Last week at Auburn they were down 10-0 in the first quarter. Rallied to win both times. Jared Zirkle to kick off. 22 touchbacks in 36 kickoffs. Kicking into a pretty good breeze, so he pooches it high in the air, and a fair catch made at the 31-yard line. Smartly so by Isaiah Cummings. So here's Devin Leary in his first year in Kentucky as a transfer from NC State, and as Greg said at the outset, has been mediocre. He's disappointed at his own play and the completion percentage indicative of it, just 58%. He's had a lot of bad balls.
And he has a huge arm. I mean, very, very strong arm, but the accuracy from time to time has been a little bit off. Gonna have to be great today to complement that run game.
Has Ray Davis, and Ray Davis picking up right where he left off last week. And he's not afraid to initiate the contact, as you saw at the end of the run when he collided with Javon Bullard after a gain of 8.
And the contain is going to be very important for Georgia defensively. Last week Auburn was really able to win on the perimeter an awful lot. That time number 32, Chaz Chambliss, he gets kind of stuck inside, and Ray Davis wins the race to the edge.
Davis, the leading rusher in the SEC, 119 yards per game. Deep throw, single coverage. Bearing on Brown couldn't handle it. Their best cover corner, Kamari Lassiter, was running with him. Lassiter's been hampered by a foot sprain. So here's third down and two. Liam Cohen, the offensive coordinator, said we have to be aggressive early. He thought 2 years ago, when they played Georgia, he waited way too long to be aggressive and didn't give his offense its best chance. An early long bomb dialed up by the 37-year-old who's come back to Kentucky after a season back with the Los Angeles Rams. Plenty of time for Leary. And the catch by Tavion Robinson with just enough for the first down.
And this ball is coming 100 miles an hour. And Tavion Robinson's a guy in this offense that really needs to start to come on. He's excellent after the catch. They clearly like him on third down quite a bit. Dane Key's the guy they focus on in the red zone. Berrion Brown's the well-rounded number one guy, but Tavion Robinson's a weapon with the ball in his hand, so he needs to get going in this ball game.
His 173rd career catch. 16th among active FBS players. Davis the other way. First down across midfield. Jordan Dingle was a lead blocker and then some, and it's a much improved offensive line this year.
And a great job here as you see the counter action. The right guard Jagger Burton out in front. His tight end Jordan Dingle there as well, pulling around. And Kentucky's run game picking up right where it left off last week against Florida.
They dominated the Gators. Davis again waits patiently. There is a flag down back near the line of scrimmage. Warren Brinson made the tackle. Part of the defensive line for Georgia. Kyle Olson is the referee leading this SEC crew.
Holding offense number 62. 10-yard penalty remains first down.
Jagger Burton, the sophomore, making his 19th consecutive start. Hometown player for Mark Stoops out of Lexington, Kentucky.
That's a big penalty as Jagger Burton, they go to a very similar play that they ran just a moment ago. Jagger Burton engages with Chaz Chambliss and throws him to the ground a little late. But when you get behind the sticks against Georgia, it is so incredibly difficult because when they get their pass rushers on, their speed guys up front, it becomes very, very tough to contain.
Wiped out a 7-yard run. First down and 20. Leary giving all kinds of time, trying to throw it to Davis on a wheel route, and it's out of bounds. He was well covered by Jamon Dumas Johnson, outstanding linebacker, one of the leaders of the defense. He was a Butkus Award finalist last year.
He's terrific. Obviously, him and Smile Mundon have played a lot of football together. Their communication is seamless, and they're the reason, in the absence of all the great players along the defensive line, why this defense is still capable of playing at a really high level.
Second and 20. Kentucky trying to overcome the holding penalty. You saw the look on Mark Stoops's face. Don't think he liked that call. Davis stumbled ahead for four. In his 11th year is Mark Stoops. Slowly built it up to the point now where they've played in seven straight bowl games. He is the winningest coach in school history, surpassed Bear Bryant's 60 wins. He's also the longest tenured coach in Kentucky football history. Kentucky, one of those rare teams that will huddle, and they play at the slowest pace in FBS football. They take that play clock down to the end just about every time. Again, plenty of time for Leary as a man wide open, and it's over the head of Tavion Robinson. And that's been the issue, the lack of accuracy, as Leary gets used to a new offense and new teammates. He's just been off target.
And man, this is one you just absolutely have to hit. It's a great call by Liam Cohen, kind of a smash concept with a corner route and someone in the flat holding that defender. He's got a guy wide open, might be a touchdown if you drop it in the bucket.
Wilson buried a punt. See Mark Stoops say, just throw it to him. I think part of it's probably mental now for Leary, who was actually known for his accuracy when he was the quarterback at NC State. Mekhi Muse, the punt return, 36-yard punt, 4-yard return, 7-0 Georgia. Greg, it looked like Kentucky had something going on that opening drive. The holding penalty was a killer.
Yeah, absolute killer. As you could see, the right guard, Jagger Burton, as he engages with Chambliss, he throws him to the ground and kind of grabs that jersey with his right hand. It was completely unnecessary. It was an attitude play for sure. And you know that Mark Stoops has emphasized that all game long, but really completely unnecessary and stalled the drive.
So Georgia leading 7-0, went easily down the field in seven plays on their first possession. Carson Beck 4 for 4. And comes out firing again, still perfect, first down. Ra-Ra Thomas the catch for a 12-yard gain, the transfer from Mississippi State, where he was the Bulldogs' leading receiver last year.
And he's got a chance, I think, to really grow within this offense. He has great speed, really good down the field.
Covered by Maxwell Hairston. Here's the first catch for Brock Bowers, the nation's leading tight end with 30 catches for 413 yards. All of those numbers lead all FBS tight ends. 157 yards receiving in the win at Auburn. He was huge down the stretch.
What's so incredible is just how good he is once he receives the football. I mean, after the catch is where he goes from being an elite player to a crazy elite player, maybe the best in all of football.
Scored the game-winning touchdown with under 3 minutes to go. At Auburn last week, Beck over the middle. Oscar Delp, the number two tight end, about a yard short of the first down. It'll be third down and one. Beck 7 out of 7. He closed the game last week in Auburn, bringing them back, completing 12 of his last 15 on their last three possessions for 201 yards, three straight touchdown drives for the come-from-behind win. Faked it to Edwards, man wide open. It's Bowers taken down inside the 40 by Maxwell Hairston. They'll mark it at the 36.
You can tell, obviously, Kirby Smart trusts his quarterback. You have short yard situation. Kentucky completely selling out against the run. Brock Bowers slips into the secondary, and Beck hits his man in for another big conversion.
Yeah, you can't lose sight of him. 25-yard gain. Brad White, the defensive coordinator for Kentucky, yesterday said he thinks Bowers is the best player in college football. And job one tonight is stopping him. They didn't that time. Here he comes again, a tight end screen. Good for 11 more. Mike Bobo. There's Brad White trying to stop Bowers. Mike Bobo, the offensive coordinator, constantly trying to come up with new ways to get the ball to Bowers.
Yeah, they'll hand it to him even as a traditional running back. He's got 16 career carries and actually handed it to him last week on a little fullback dive. So just an incredibly versatile weapon. It's got to be so much fun for Mike Bobo to design plays to get him the ball.
Bobo replaced Todd Monken, who left after last season to be the offensive coordinator for the Baltimore Ravens. Back wide open in the flat. Edwards dives down, looked to be just a little bit short of the line to gain, but they might have given him the bounce. And Beck just cannot miss.
A lot of it too has to do with protection. I mean, if you look at just how much time he's had to operate, I mean, he's had a clean pocket. He's obviously getting the ball out really quickly, but this pass rush for Kentucky has to show up at some point or he'll pick you apart.
10 for 10 for 131. They're averaging more than 10 yards per play on their first two possessions. To the end zone, and it is incomplete. Ra-Ra Thomas went in the air, but couldn't get down in bounds.
Really close. A great job by Thomas high pointing it. But look at that left foot. Looks like that foot actually lands in bounds as he was going to the ground. Take a look at that left foot.
I agree.
Secures the catch. Looks like that left foot is down. Might want to take another look at this.
Yeah, there's the left foot. They are going to stop it.
Rolling on the field of an incomplete pass is under video review.
And that left foot's down first before the right foot comes down out of bounds. Well, they take a look at it. We'll step aside. Stan Murray is the replay official tonight.
After video review, it is a touchdown. The receiver had one foot in bounds and found control of the ball.
So a touchdown, his first as a Georgia Bulldog, and celebration on the sideline. Ra-Ra Thomas. And Mike Bobo making all the right calls. Two possessions, two long touchdown drives. This one, seven plays, 82 yards. All seven plays were passes. And the extra point good by Peyton Woodring. Thomas, one of those transfers they brought over to bolster the receiving core. Caught 44 last year for Mississippi State, had seven touchdowns, and Lovett right next to him over from Missouri, where he was second team all SEC for the Tigers last year.
This is just a tremendous throw as well. High, where only his receiver can go up and get it. Obviously, Thomas times his jump perfectly to high point it, and somehow miraculously gets that left foot down in bounds. Just a tremendous effort, and I don't think you could ask for a better start from what's been a very slow starting Georgia football team.
For Kirby Smart, now in his eighth season as head coach at his alma mater, 86 and 15 is the record. His 85% winning percentage through 100 games, the best in the history of the Southeastern Conference among any coach, and they've had some of the great coaches of all time. Jared Zirkel kicks off. And it is mishandled by Anthony Brown Stevens. And he goes out of the back of the end zone, and it's a touchback. The true freshman back there receiving the kickoff, and nearly a nightmare. Here's Matt Berry. It's already been a great day of college football, Matt, starting with the Red River rivalry. What a classic that was. That game never disappoints. Ray Davis squirts up the middle for three. Here's Molly McGrath.
Sean, on that last drive, quarterback Devin Leary was off the mark to wide receiver Tavion Robinson. He came off to the sideline and talked to Robinson about their timing. And, you know, you've talked about it. Leary's taken responsibility for their offensive struggles, telling us our passing game is inconsistent right now. I need to take a good, hard look in the mirror. It starts with me. I need to be better in every way. Accuracy, ball placement, timing, reading the defense, everything. Sean?
That was a textbook example of it. Wide open receiver and a big miss. Second and 7. Looking deep again. Another wide open receiver caught this time by Dane Key. And into Georgia territory again. So Liam Cohen said they would take some shots, and they are.
And this is a great route. Kind of fakes the post to the inside, just a deep V route. And Key beats his man Lassiter to the inside, breaks it back out, and a really nice throw there from Leary.
36-yard play. From the 36 of Georgia. And another quality gain on first down. It's Berrion Brown, the sophomore from Nashville. There is a flag back near the 35-yard line. I think if you're Liam Cohen, this is a promising start. You know, they moved the ball on the first drive. The holding penalty hurt. They had a wide open receiver they missed. And here they are moving the ball well again.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, offense, number 62. 15-yard penalty, down counts.
It was Burton's holding penalty that hurt them on the first drive. And now another big penalty. You're not going to come in here and beat number one for the first time since 2007 if you keep doing this.
And just really dumb penalty from Jagger Burton. I mean, after the play, the umpire's right there, basically body slams a Georgia defender.
It's Eli Cox at center. Burton's playing right guard. Davis driven back by Chaz Chambliss.
As you can see, just a great job at the front. They've run that play with some success already, but this time Chambliss plays it perfectly and makes the play behind the line of scrimmage.
Chambliss, a first-year starter, was an important backup the last couple of years. Junior from Carrollton, Georgia. 2.5 to go, first quarter. And another penalty. Looked like it was the right tackle, Jeremy Flax.
False start. Offense, number 77. 5-yard penalty. Nice start down.
Let's go back to the personal foul. As you can see, guys on the ground, but watch Jagger Burton on the left side of your screen.
Wow.
He's going right down. The umpire's looking right at it. Just a completely ridiculous decision by him that has him staring at 3rd and 26.
Here comes pressure. Leary given time, and it's too high for Dane Key. A fired up Kamari Lassiter had the coverage for Georgia. Preseason first team All-SEC cornerback. And Burton has really hurt his team here in the first quarter. That last one was just about as stupid as it gets.
Just absolutely can't make decisions like that. It's an emotional game, obviously. You've been preached to all week. We got to match their physicality. You can't do it after the whistle. It's just completely uncalled for.
Wilson Berry, the 25-year-old from Australia, brother of Jordan Berry, who's punted in the NFL. Kai Mews let it bounce, and Kentucky's going to down it near the 1-yard line. Andrew Phillips in the right place. Looks like they're going to mark it at the 2. Kirby Smart letting Muse have it. Next week, a top 10 matchup in the Pac-12. On ABC, 3:30 Eastern, number 8, Oregon, number 7, Washington. 123-year rivalry. It's the first time both teams will be ranked in the top 10 when facing each other. Don't like to interrupt the referee. They are the top two teams in the country in yards per game, both over 550. Both on a bye this week, so they'll be rested and ready to go.
That game is going to be electric, man. Great quarterbacks, obviously Bo Nix with Oregon, Michael Penix, who I think if the Heisman was awarded at the end of September, he would probably have gotten my vote. He's been playing phenomenal.
Carson Beck has completed his first 11. Here's Dylan Bell around the corner. And knocked out of bounds at the 32-yard line. He got 27. Trying to help get the running game going, primarily a wide receiver, but they're using him as a running back, and now there's a flag on that play. It looks like it'll be the first Georgia penalty.
Personal foul, illegal blindside block, offense, number 73. Half the distance of the goal, remains first down.
Xavier Truss, who was the starting left guard at the beginning of the year. They lost Amarius Mims to a right ankle injury. He'll be out for several more weeks, so they moved Truss from left guard to right tackle. And Dylan Fairchild moved in at left guard.
And that's a big loss, obviously, with Mims being out, such an anchor there on the right side. But Truss, I think, has filled his big shoes admirably. The run game, for whatever reason, though, amongst the offensive line, just has yet to really get going. Protection's been pretty good, but would love to see that group start to play with a little bit more in the run game to help out their young quarterback.
It's Edwards looking for some space, and he has the first down, taken down by De'Eric Jackson, the senior linebacker back in his home state. He's from Dublin, Georgia. 10 yards and another UGA first down.
That right there was a great job by the Georgia offensive line. I mean, Xavier Truss making up for the mistake a moment ago. He was engaged with his defender 10, 11 yards downfield as he was getting that surge.
17 points total in the first five games in the first quarter for Georgia, 14 tonight. Beck, 11 out of 11. Beck fires and it's incomplete. Broken up by Andrew Phillips. There is another flag down. Trevin Wallace put a hit on Beck as he delivered the football.
They're going to get Kendall Milton, who picked up the blitzing linebacker and grabbed the jersey.
These officials are very conversational here in the first quarter.
Holding, offense, number 2, half the distance to the goal, makes first down.
This is a tough ask for Kendall Milton. He's working against J.J. Weaver, who obviously is an excellent pass rusher in his own right. He engages initially, but as Weaver and Beck both slide to the left, he hangs on just a little bit too long. But, man, that's an impossible ask. You got a dynamic edge rusher working against your running back, and that edge rusher is going to win the battle 95% of the time.
So Beck is still perfect at 11 for 11, which is the fourth longest consecutive completion streak to start a game in Georgia history. The record is 15 in a row to open a game. Edwards taken down at the 15-yard line. Trevin Wallace in on the tackle. Gain of 6. They don't have to snap it again here in the first quarter, unless they choose to. And Kirby Smart saying, we're not going to snap it again. ...183 yards of offense in the opening quarter for Georgia. Beck 11 for 11 for 146 and 2 touchdowns. And a couple of costly penalties against Kentucky. The end of the first quarter, Georgia 14, Kentucky nothing. SEC on ESPN from Sanford Stadium in Athens, Georgia. On a beautiful night, the temperature in the low 60s. Expect to get down in the mid 50s by the end of the game. Sean McDonough, Greg McElroy, Molly McGrath. Our producer is Phil Dean and our director, Scott Johnson. Outstanding first quarter on offense for Georgia. Carson Beck now 12 for 12. Short completion to Ra-Ra Thomas. A moment ago, Molly with Coach Stoops.
Coach, Carson Beck is 11 for 11. How do you affect him?
We're not affecting him very good, except for that last one there. We got some pressure on him finally and got a hold and got him in some negative yardage, but they're off to a fast start.
How frustrating are those penalties?
I mean, it's killing us. Our offense is, you know, we're staying on track and then we're getting our penalties. You can't do that. You can't come in here and get penalties like that.
All right, thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Last win for Kentucky against Georgia was in 2009. They've lost 13 straight. And that pass batted out of the air by Deion Walker. Kentucky players think it's a free ball. Here comes another flag as a Georgia player got knocked to the ground. Deion Walker dumped Cedric Van Pran. Well, he said the penalties are a killer, and they have been, and this might be another one. I was a little surprised after the WWE elbow drop by Barton that he didn't come out of the game, at least for a little bit. I know they're not particularly deep along the offensive line, but at some point.
Going on the field is an incomplete pass. After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, defense, number zero, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, and an automatic first down.
It was a great play by Walker initially. Knows he's not going to get there. 6'6", 350, going up and knocking the ball down. Then for whatever reason, I don't know what he was thinking. I mean, that's just completely unnecessary. Why is Kentucky advancing the ball? It was clearly an incompletion. And then Walker does something dumb like that to give Georgia's offense new life. Just killing themselves right now.
The best defensive lineman not on the field right now. The ball out to the 35, four penalties for 45 yards against Kentucky. Kendall Milton is the running back. He's been banged up here in the early season. He scoots ahead for 7. He was their third leading rusher last year. They lost Kendall McIntosh to the NFL draft. They lost a lot of key players from a year ago. Of course, Stetson Bennett, the back-to-back national championship winning quarterback drafted by the Rams. They lost both starting offensive tackles. McIntosh, an important pass receiver out of the backfield as well. Darnell Washington, great number two tight end alongside Bowers, drafted in the third round. Dominic Lovett. And they had a very important receiver, Adonai Mitchell, transferred to Texas. Dominic Blaylock to Georgia Tech. Harris Jackson made the Tennessee Titans undrafted. That's a lot of talent to replace. Usually you focus on the defensive players they lose to the draft. But
it's been a ton of turnover, obviously, and they really missed Darnell Washington, I think. Obviously, third round pick, but his physical build and just how imposing he was as a run blocker, that's the guy they might miss as much as anybody.
He was a mammoth blocker and a good pass receiver. Beck fires downfield, and Arian Smith couldn't come up with it. And you mentioned it. Where has Arian Smith been? So highly touted when he came here. Now a junior, and they're still waiting for greatness.
And it's in there. I mean, you've seen it in moments, but situations like that. I mean, it's obviously a well-thrown ball by Carson Beck. He's got to reel that in. I mean, he's got incredible speed, stuff that you just can't teach. But the inconsistencies have kind of plagued him, and that's why he's never really become the superstar at this point that we thought he might become.
Milton looked like he might get dragged down to the line. Instead, he got ahead for five. Senior from Fresno, California.
I think maybe four down territory here if you're Kirby Smart.
Going with quick tempo, third down and five, movement along the line. Looks like it's going against Kentucky, and the ball is caught by Rosemy Jackson. Looked like Deion Walker was offside. And if the play stands, it's 30 yards and a Georgia first down.
Ruling on the field, it's a completed catch. Offside, defense number zero in the neutral zone at the time of the snap. That penalty is declined. Felton play is first down.
A great job by Carson Beck, seeing that the defender had jumped off sides, knowing he has a one-on-one shot down the left sideline. Free play, take a chance. And Rosemy Jackson, their strongest receiver on the perimeter, drags it in.
Beck, 14 for 16 for 188 and two touchdowns. Now they flip it to the speedy Smith. Oh, what a tackle. He got crunched. There is a flag down. It was Zion Childress who delivered the hit. When Smith was in high school, he was a nationally competitive sprinter and has spent some time on the Georgia track team as well as a sprinter.
There are two fouls on the play, one by each team. Holding, offense, number two. Offside, defense, number 90. Those fouls offset, first down.
You know, like, this is a big moment for Mark Stoops. I mean, just Georgia's been able to do whatever they want. They've had so many self-inflicted mistakes, but to hold them to a field goal here would be massive for the Wildcats.
And they've made their name primarily on defense in the Stoops area, but they're getting gashed over and over again. Beck tried to get it to Bowers. Childress had the coverage.
The first bad decision by Carson Beck so far. At this part of the field, they always look towards Brock Bowers, and clearly Kentucky was aware of that as Childress was all over it, almost baited Carson Beck into throwing it right to him.
He asked Beck yesterday about Brock Bowers. He said he's superhuman.
He most
and
definitely
it's hard to argue
is.
When you watch them play. He can do everything, including block. You know, he's not just pass receiving tight end. He is a spirited and effective blocker. Ladd McConkey the catch. Battling the back problems. He got 11 on that catch for a first down.
And just soft coverage on the outside by Maxwell Hairston, and they're going to take those hitches all day long. I understand why they'd be soft too. This part of the field, they had just thrown one on the second touchdown.
Played only 24 snaps, but three of those four catches last week at Auburn were on third down and good for first down conversions. Very important player on third down. Wide open Oscar Delp for the Georgia touchdown.
You're going to see, obviously, a full sell by Kentucky against the run. A similar play that they hit Brock Bowers on earlier. Just completely selling out against the run. They slip the tight end right up the middle, and Delp reels it in for a touchdown. What a backbreaker for Kentucky after they had him off the field earlier in the drive.
Second touchdown of the year for Delp. Highly recruited sophomore from Cumming, Georgia. On the top tight end recruits coming out of high school a couple of years ago. They went 95 yards in 13 plays, helped again by Kentucky penalties. Beck's thrown three touchdown passes already. Louisville unbeaten. Notre Dame still number 10 in the country after the excruciating loss to Ohio State. Kickoff is a touchback. Here are the college football rankings brought to you by Goodyear. There is Notre Dame at number 10. Michigan playing tonight and leading at Minnesota 10-0 in a huge win for Oklahoma. 6-7 a year ago in the first season under Brent Venables. What a performance today in a wild back and forth game.
Just an incredible game, and I think Oklahoma has grown so tremendously from year one to year two. Obviously knocking off Texas, who's as complete as anybody from a roster standpoint. That was a massive win for Brent Venables, but I can't say it's shocking with how much progress they've shown.
They marched down the field in the final 2 minutes without a timeout to score the winning touchdown. Ray Davis, another beautifully designed and executed play, good for 11. Smile Munden made the tackle.
Gotta be pretty frustrating if you're Liam Cohen. You've had a pretty good plan. You've been able to move the football, but obviously a couple penalties really offsetting any of that progress. But he's been more aggressive. He's got Georgia kind of going side to side. He's taken a couple shots. He's had guys open.
Yeah, they're moving the ball. I mean, they've only run 14 plays, but they're averaging 5.7 yards per play. And the line is protecting Larry well. He's on target again for a first down to midfield to Dane Key. 16 more. Malachi Starks made the tackle.
And a great job up front. I mean, tremendous protection allows Devin Leary to kind of stand back there and survey, and he throws a strike. You see the velocity perfectly placed there to his big body receiver, Dane Key.
Well, he had a terrific year 2 years ago at NC State, did Devin Leary. 35 touchdown passes for the Wolfpack and only 5 interceptions. As a result of that, prior to last season, he was the ACC preseason player of the year. He tore a pec last year, needed surgery, and he hasn't been the same guy here. He got hit as he threw that one, and it still was almost caught by Demi Sumo Kangbe. There is a flag down. Words that we have spoken a few times already tonight. Not only do they throw a lot of flags, they talk a lot about it before they actually tell us what's happening. And those microphones work too, right? I mean, they're supposed to be able to talk to each other.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Defense, number 97. 15-yard penalty.
Warren Brinson, part of an all senior starting defensive line. Wow.
Man, I don't know about that one. I mean, it's a little high, I suppose, but
that's
if you hit
bad.
Him, if you hit a blow, I mean,
it's not late, it's not to the head.
Yeah, I don't agree with that call.
That's bad. Really bad. But big for Kentucky. To the 34-yard line. They've been moving the ball consistently. They've just dug themselves a huge hole, and that one dropped. That's been another problem. It hasn't all been on Leary. The low completion percentage. Tavion Robinson couldn't take that one in. Let's bring in Matt Austin.
Yeah, I agree with you guys on that hit on the quarterback. I don't think it's roughing the passer. You say it's not late. It's a little high. I think what might have fooled the referee is he looked like he did kind of an upward thrust and kind of dove at the quarterback, and that may be what he thought he saw, but there wasn't much there.
Second down and 10. Davis juggled the ball for a moment after taking the handoff. Jamon Dumas Johnson made the tackle, a gain of 2.
Yeah, that was wild. Good call too, because he does kind of juggle it as he's trying to secure it and get it to his left hand, his outside arm. Ball kind of pops up, and fortunate that thing didn't get away.
Davis on his third college team, started his career at Temple, 2 years there, 2 at Vanderbilt. And now a very productive first year at Kentucky. Will he get the ball on 3rd and 8? Georgia brings pressure. Davis stays in to help pick it up. That ball is incomplete. Intended for Berrion Brown. Dalen Everett, who gets most of the action at the corner opposite Lassiter, had the coverage. And help from Javon Bullard.
Probably thinking four down territory here too. And don't blame Leary for taking the shot 1-on-1 down the field, but would love to make this fourth down a little more manageable. But clearly Mark Stoops sensing that they got to score a touchdown in order to stay in this ball game.
And they move. Again at the right end of the line. It might have been Flax for the second time.
Delay game. Defense. For disconcerting signals. 5-yard penalty. Makes fourth down.
And this is a good call. You look at number 18, Xavier Ansori. Look at, you see him say move. And as soon as he says move, those defensive linemen will shift. That was something that Kentucky had talked about, said that they were going to address it with the officials beforehand, and that time they get the call.
That was Glenn Schumann, the defensive coordinator. He said that's something Georgia does at home. They don't do it on the road. Obviously, the crowd helps. Much more manageable fourth down. Georgia crowding the line. Leary on target. And Tavion Robinson the first down. They'll mark him just inside the 22.
Well, defensive players would call this a pick. Offensive players will call this a rub. But it's a good job there by number 7, Berrion Brown. He actually turns and tries to become a wide receiver. So he sold it well.
Throw back, another good call. It's Josh Caddis, one of their tight ends. Boy, I've been impressed by the play calling by Liam Cohen here in the first half. That's 8 more on the screen to Caddis, a sophomore tight end. His dad Eric played at Michigan and 7 years in the NFL.
Completely agree with you on the play calling. I know they don't have any points to show for it, but my goodness, man, Liam Cohen is off to a really nice start in this game. Getting a lot of guys involved with a lot of misdirection.
Well, they've done a nice job of mixing up the play calling. And again, an open receiver, Tavion Robinson in the flat. You know, that should be a very high percentage completion. And it wasn't.
I think Leary sensed that he was about to get hit hard, as you can see. Doesn't like it, is well covered, tries to get rid of it, but he's way off the mark.
They're 1-for-4 on 3rd down. This is probably 4 down territory again. Out of the pistol. Davis, lots of running room, and a first down inside the 5.
Man, this is just a great job. This run's designed to go that way, but he cuts it back beautifully because you look at the defender there on the interior. It appears to be Warren Brinson, number 97, crosses face of that guard. Ray Davis sees it immediately, puts his left foot in the ground, and finds some open space. It's a great run by the running back.
The Georgia defense that struggled to stop the run last week at Auburn. Off the play fake, Leary, corner to the end zone, and it is caught by Josh Caddis for a Kentucky touchdown.
Just an enormous answer for Kentucky. They go with a little 3-21 loop pass right, loop that quarterback out, designed to throw it in the flat. You almost never throw it to the corner. But in this case, Leary likes the matchup. He sees the defender. Malachi Starks' back is to him, so he can fit it in there as you take a look from the progressive pylon cam.
They march 75 yards in 10 plays, and Alex Rayner, the extra point. Caddis, a sophomore from Cincinnati out of Moeller, his second career touchdown, both this season, the other against Akron. They've moved the ball well.
Let's take a look at tonight's Mark of a Fighter moment brought to you by Modelo. It's Carson Beck off to a blazing start. First drive of the game, little play action. He sees the safety, Zion Childress, run up, throws it right over the top. Perfect trajectory as Rosemy Jack Saint finds the end zone. And then on third and one, full sellout against the run, drifts away from the pressure and hits Brock Bowers for a nice conversion. How about the decision making on the RPO? He has freedom to take the one-on-one if he wants it. He gets it. He throws it exactly where you have to throw it, down on the goal line fade, high where his receiver can time the jump and reel it in. They are rolling offensively, almost entirely due to the incredible start by Carson Beck.
16 out of 19 for 204 and three touchdowns. Little squib kick by Kentucky and handled on a fair catch. Here's Matt Berry.
Gentlemen, allow me to present you our multi-view quad box on what's going on in primetime. Louisville up on Notre Dame, ABC. Ole Miss up on Arkansas, SEC Network. And Miami wearing questionable all blacks against Georgia Tech on ACC Network.
I kind of like when teams wear their own colors. Right?
It does help, doesn't
yeah.
it? It's usually real helpful to identify.
Cash Jones in at running back now for Georgia. This is their best starting field position. Three possessions, three drives, 75, 82, and 95. And here they come again. Brock Bowers. How did he get so wide open? Brad White said yesterday, job one is stopping him. This one goes for 59.
Yeah, just a complete bust in the secondary there by Kentucky. Brock Bowers, as a result, very traditional alignment. It's not like they hit him. He is wide open.
Timeout on the field for a player injury.
And as you can see, him after the catch, man, he makes the first defender miss more often than not.
Well, he runs a 4-5. At 240 pounds, it was 49 yards on the play, 28 after the catch.
You're looking at Kentucky safety Jalen Geiger walking back to the locker room with a left elbow injury. He will be further evaluated. Sean, you saw him go down with this injury, and I will keep you updated if he's available for the second half.
Trying to tackle Brock Bowers. That would be an important loss. He's an important part of their secondary. Senior from Columbia, South Carolina, from a military family. Both of his parents, Tony and Ramona, served more than 20 years in the U.S. Army. Here comes George, already three touchdowns in three possessions. Back at the Kentucky 21 to the end zone and incomplete for Ra-Ra Thomas with Andrew Phillips in coverage.
Coming into the game, I mean, you really thought that the Kentucky secondary would be good enough to be able to handle this group. They're excellent at corner, both Andrew Phillips and Maxwell Hairston. They have three safeties. Now that Geiger's out, they'll roll with two, but it's a really good secondary, and they're certainly not looking like it tonight against a really potent passing attack. As you see, Brad White does a tremendous job as the defensive coordinator.
Edwards, nifty move, and some shaky tackling. 4 yard gain for Edwards. Under 6 minutes to go in the first half. Carson Beck already up to 253 yards passing. That average is going up 300 plus in each of the previous two games, and he's going to shatter that tonight, perhaps past his career high of 338 a couple of weeks ago against UAB. looking for his fourth touchdown pass of the half. Oh my goodness, take Bauer's scholarship away. He couldn't haul it in the corner of the end zone with Alex Afari in coverage.
I mean, it's just a little stutter go. A tight end running a stutter go is ridiculous, but man, I mean, he's human. Ladies and gentlemen, that was up for debate prior to that play.
My
but
goodness, it's shocking when that happens.
See Kirby, I mean, I don't know if anyone can believe what they just witnessed.
There's Peyton Woodring, the freshman from Lafayette, Louisiana, the top-ranked kicker in high school football last year. Beck is the holder, and that 36-yarder is good. So Woodring is 7 out of 10 now in field goals in his freshman season. Mark that tape. You won't, might not.
Back here in Georgia, as tight end Brock Bowers walks into the injury tent after that last drive, he limped off and was in visible pain. Had athletic training staff working on his right leg. He tried to wave them off, but they insisted he go into the medical tent, Sean.
Take a look as kind of lands a little awkwardly. Oh, and you see at the end, it kind of, it's almost like a recoil as he went to the ground. That was uncomfortable looking.
Jared Zirkle to kickoff. And Kentucky will start at the 25. Kickoff your week 5 NFL Sunday at 10 a.m. with the countdown crew on ESPN, the app, the early breaking stories, injury updates, previews of each game right up until the kickoff, and then Monday Night Football caps off week 5. 8 p.m., the Green Bay Packers and the Las Vegas Raiders. Coverage starts with Monday Night Countdown at 6. There is a Manning cast with Peyton and Eli on ESPN2. Packers are 2-2. The Raiders are 1-3. There's Devin Leary with Ray Davis on his right hip. 5:15 to go in the half. Kentucky down by 17. Leary to the sideline. And good run after the catch by Dane Key. 13-yard gain. They continue to move the ball with regularity.
Just a nice easy route, but a good job there. Kind of drifting away a little bit. As you saw number 32, Chaz Chambliss, trying to kind of drop into that zone. He drifts away and makes it easier on his quarterback.
Leary now 9 out of 16. For 102. He threw for only 69, a 9 out of 20 last week in the win against Florida, but they had the big rushing day. Up for grabs, and it should have been intercepted by Kamari Lassiter. He had inside position on Dane Key.
Man, obviously Kamari Lassiter is going to get the pass breakup here, but I think that pass breakup should probably go to Dane Key. He did a good job of fighting through the defender. I mean, that was going to be a catch for sure from Lassiter, but the contact from Key is what ultimately broke up the pass.
Outstanding player, junior from Savannah, one of the top cornerback prospects on Mel Kiper's big board with an eye toward next year's draft. George has had 8 interceptions this season, tied for 3rd in the nation. Nearly had another. Leary off target. He had a man curling open, Anthony Brown Stevens, the true freshman from Springfield, Ohio.
And these are the down and distances that are so difficult against Kirby Smart and this Georgia defense. They bring in their speed. You bring in Jalen Walker. You bring in Xavien Sori. And they're just going to pin their ears back with those pass rushers and make life very difficult for this Kentucky offensive line and Devin Leary.
Clock at 2. They just did get it off, and he's under duress and buried back at the 25. Jamon Dumas Johnson. His 2nd sack of the season, a 13-yard loss.
And just a great design here by Glenn Schumann. And you're going to see guys wing around and all kinds of stuff. They bring Lassiter off the right-hand side. He's unblocked. But Dumas Johnson's able to fight through a little bit of traffic as the offensive line, the right side just couldn't quite pick up that overload blitz from the right.
Wilson Berry on 4th and 23. Short punt. Kai Muse caught it on the run. George of excellent field position, just a 30-yard kick. Here's Matt.
Okay, gentlemen, coming up, Mercedes-Benz halftime report. Alabama airs it out in their win against Texas A&M. Plus, we had a Red River thriller in the great state of Texas. And the Buckeyes, sloppy early, finish strong late. Dan Mullen, Joey Galloway joining me coming up on the Mercedes-Benz halftime report.
All right, Matt, we look forward to it. Yeah, Ohio State had a tussle early with Maryland. Maryland was ahead 10-0 in that game. Texas was 10 down, rallied to take a late lead against Oklahoma, and then gave up a touchdown in the final seconds. Brock Bowers is on the sideline as this possession begins for Georgia, with Edwards running off left guard and powering his way for a first down and more. Here's Molly.
Well, Sean Bowers came out of the injury tent with a wrap on his right calf. He went immediately to his offensive line and said, "I'm good to go," and I'm told he's fine. He will return.
And he is back in there. It's kind of easy to give somebody treatment on their leg when they're wearing shorts.
The knee pad's really more of like a mid-thigh pad.
Yeah, like a cut-off shorts.
Probably excellent, though, on like a Peloton bike or something. You know what I mean?
Cedric Van Pran, the center, is the injured player. He's a stalwart, 36 consecutive starts, most on the Georgia team. And really, they're playing with six offensive linemen. They're more thin at that position than they've been during this championship run. Jared Wilson is the backup center, getting ready to come in, but he's played very little.
That is not someone that you want to be without for an extended period of time. Cedric Van Pran is kind of the heart and soul of this offensive line. Obviously a great signal caller, and with a relatively inexperienced quarterback, having a guy up front that can communicate and handle all the calls is imperative, and him not being there obviously could have an impact on this quarterback significantly.
Let's bring in Matt Austin. Matt, there was a time I thought you were supposed to wear knee pads and the whole thing. And now we're seeing a lot of guys who look like they're out there in shorts. What say you?
Well, to strictly follow the rules, yes, you're supposed to wear pants with knee pads. But what the officials are instructed to do is during pregame, they're to go around, take a look at the players. If a player's got their pants rolled way up, go to them, ask them, make them show the official that they can pull the pants down at least to the top of the knee. If they can, then they're fine. If they can't, they're supposed to turn it over to the trainer. But once the game starts, they're not going to police the knee pads and the pants.
All right, Matt, thank you. No fashion police between the hedges here tonight. .3:10 to go in the half. Kendall Milton is the running back. Each team with all three timeouts. Kentucky brings a blitz. Deep drop by Beck, and Rosemary Jackson, another big play. He was wide open for a 21-yard completion.
And this is a heck of a throw by Carson Beck. The defender is almost there as Childress is chasing, but he holds up Rosemary Jackson on the back shoulder, shields off the wide receiver from the defender, and he's able to get big and reel that one in. That's just a terrific throw by Carson Beck.
99 yards receiving. He had the 40-yard touchdown to Rosemary Jackson for the first score of the game. Milton, they couldn't chop him down at the line. And he wound up with about a 6-yard gain. It was Andrew Phillips who missed the tackle. Now, if I were Kentucky, Greg, I would be calling timeouts. But yeah, you've moved the ball. You would like to get the ball back before the end of the half.
And
you're already down three scores.
And they get the ball, obviously, coming out at halftime as well. So possibility to go 2-for-1. I don't know if I would be calling timeout just this early, just yet. But probably when you get around the 90-second mark.
Well, why not?
because they're looking like they're probably going to get another first down right here.
Well, but Georgia has all three of their timeouts. They have all kinds of time, and they're on the 15-yard line. Time is no problem for them with an eye towards scoring again. If anything, they'd probably like to take as much time off as they can and then score. Bowers for 10 yards.
Now I would start thinking about calling timeout if I were Kentucky.
And you see Kirby pointing at the clock as if to say, hey, use some time.
This is one right here. If I'm Kentucky, I'm definitely calling timeout. I mean, you preserve and maybe your defense holds.
I don't understand this. When you're down 17 points, you need as many possessions as you can get. You've moved the ball when you've had it. And Georgia not in any hurry. Takes the clock all the way down. A low snap and a touchdown. Kendall Milton. And it's 30-7 Georgia.
And just a great job here by the right side of the offensive line. As you can see on the right side, Xavier Truss just securing the edge and kind of hooking the defender inside as Khalil Sanders has no chance with that type of leverage, and Milton finds Pater.
Yeah. First rushing touchdown of the game, second of the season for Milton. Woodring, the extra point is good. Georgia has scored on all five first half possessions to the delight of Boom. Now a quick word from Verbo.
Verbo, football away, baby.
They're having a good time on that Georgia sideline, and why not? Very impressive performance. I mentioned Greg, Kirby Smart told us yesterday, usually I feel like I know more about my team five games into the season. I'm still learning as we go. I think he has to be very pleased with what he's learning about his team tonight.
Yeah, he's got to be thrilled. I mean, they've found out pretty quickly that they're going to be a great passing football team. I mean, Carson Beck unproven coming into this year, but he is the backbone of what they're doing offensively. They clearly have elite weapons, and their defense is holding up pretty well tonight.
Jared Zirkle's kickoff will be a touchback, and of course they've been helped from the very beginning by a lot of Kentucky mistakes.
Yeah, huge mistakes. Jagger Burton been one of the guys that has stalled a couple drives. There he gets called for the hold, gets it behind the sticks. This play is just inexcusable. I mean, late and decide to take a shot on it. Obviously the umpire sees it clearly, and then a little bit later on, it's third down, you're off the field, you knock the ball down, then you decide to take a shot at Cedric Van Pran by Deion Walker. Just really bad mistakes tonight have really killed Kentucky, and it's, if you give extra life to the Georgia Bulldogs, you don't stand a chance.
And they've moved it in spurts, but again, they've been hurt by the inconsistent accuracy of Leary. He's made some nice throws as he did on the touchdown, but he's also missed some wide open receivers that would have been big plays. Davis stopped for a 2-yard gain. I mean, they're trying to hurry up. They have all three of their timeouts. The pressure picked up, and the ball is incomplete. It hit Berrion Brown with Kamari Lassiter running in coverage.
Yeah, now you start to think, too. I mean, Georgia could start thinking about some timeouts, maybe steal a field goal before the half. Obviously, going to be field position dependent on whether or not, but given how well Carson Beck's played and how much of a struggle it's been for Kentucky in the secondary, this might be an opportunity for Kirby Smart to start to get aggressive if they're able to
stop
the Wildcats.
Yeah, you saw one of the assistant coaches whispering to Kirby Smart. It was probably the idea of a timeout if they stop this play. 35 seconds in the half. They bring extra rushers again, and the throw is incomplete. Diving attempt by Anthony Brown Stevens. He couldn't get there.
Now, I mean, Georgia has three timeouts, a red hot quarterback.
a wide receiver group that has been tremendous tonight.
Kirby yelling at Mekhi Muse. That's the first three and out of the game for either team.
Maybe they come after this one too.
Berry got it off. Good kick, very high, and a fair catch made by Muse. Now a quick word from Verbo. Football away indeed. Georgia looking for its 23rd straight win. And Carson Beck, 284 yards passing, the most in a half by a Georgia quarterback in the last 20 seasons, and they've had some big numbers put up over the last two decades. Let's see if they get aggressive. You would think they would, with as well as they've moved it. There was some movement, but no flags. They are going deep in the single coverage and incomplete. Intended for Ra-Ra Thomas, and here come the flags. Jordan Robinson had the coverage.
Pass interference, defense for 28, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
I think this is a good call by the official. Throws just a little bit outside, but as you can see, Robinson looks back for a second but doesn't really try to play the ball. That's a good call by the official.
Robinson's really been their third corner, playing behind Hairston and Phillips, transfer from Division II Livingstone College in Salisbury, North Carolina. So the ball moved to the 47. Of Kentucky. Still 17 seconds and all three timeouts. They check it down to Edwards. And that should be in field goal range after an 11-yard gain. They stop the clock, does Georgia, with 10 seconds to go and now two timeouts left.
Timeout, Georgia, their first of the half. 30 seconds in lead.
We talked to Carson Beck yesterday. You know, he was very highly recruited coming out of Jacksonville, Florida. He grew up idolizing our
tremendous arm talent, and he makes great decisions. I mean, I came under some heat for whatever reason because the deep ball hasn't really been there with the same level of consistency that I think a lot of Georgia fans would have liked. But in order to really be able to create big plays in the passing game downfield, you got to have a great run game.
Well, I don't think they have to worry about the deep ball accuracy after what we've seen tonight.
It's there, that's for sure. He's got big time ability, but here an opportunity. If I'm Kentucky, they're already in field goal range. I'm blitzing big time here to try and knock them out of field goal range. So let's see if they decide to do that and if Carson Beck can process it quickly.
Woodring's long is 38, but in the high school he made a 60-yard field goal. And a couple of more than 50 last year. This will get him closer to the 24-yard line. Edwards, a 12-yard gain.
Timeout, Georgia. Their second timeout of the half.
And that's textbook.
30 seconds in length.
Time management and execution. Beck up to 307 yards in the half.
He is just picking them apart, man. I mean, great understanding, nothing there downfield. Take a quick glance, you got your outlet. Getting through his progression really quickly as he talks to his backup center there.
Yeah, he might not always be a part of the field goal unit. Perhaps he's just congratulating for the nice job he did on that drive coming in for Van Pran. So the career long is 38. He's only tried one so far in college of more than 40. And he missed a 43-yarder here against South Carolina. So this would be a career long of 42. If he can knock this one through, likely to end the half. William Moat is the veteran snapper and Beck the holder. That looked like the form of a young man who was the number one high school kicker in the country last year. What a half for Georgia. Couple of field goals by Woodring, three touchdown passes by Beck. They had six possessions, they scored on all of them. and undefeated Kentucky. Did a lot of damage to itself in that first half. Some big penalties, especially early. Here's Molly McGrath.
Coach, over 300 yards passing. What do you attribute that strong start to?
A composed quarterback and a good offensive plan. They're doing a good job. The biggest thing we're doing is being able to run the ball, and that sets up the play action.
Will you continue to be aggressive, especially in the passing game in the second half?
Well, we're not playing great defense, and they've got a good plan for us, so we got to score points.
All right, thanks, Coach.
At the half, Georgia 34 and Kentucky 7. We'll send you to the studio to the always happy Matt Barry for the Mercedes-Benz halftime report. And from Sanford Stadium in Athens, Georgia, the number one team in the country, seemingly on its way to its 23rd straight win, Georgia leading Kentucky 34-7. Sean McDonough and Greg McElroy. And if the Georgia fans were worried about who's going to be the quarterback after Stetson Bennett, I'm not sure they have reason to continue to worry about it.
I think that position's just fine. I mean, Carson Beck, just a clinic in the first half. I mean, I think you could count maybe once, twice where the ball wasn't catchable. I mean, he played phenomenal. And the receivers, too, I think they've really stepped up. I mean, there have been some contested catches. Rosemy Jack Saint has been very, very reliable. Brock Bowers, of course, he's always amazing. But I really believe this passing attack is starting to come into its own. And I think as Kirby Smart and as you've alluded to, I think he's starting to figure out exactly who this team is and how they're going to attack people.
Kentucky will get the ball first to begin the second half. They'll be very disappointed with the way that first half transpired. Their own worst enemy early with some key penalties. Again, sporadic accuracy from Devin Leary, just 9 out of 20 in that first half, despite the fact he had a lot of people open. Mark Stoops saying tonight was an opportunity for a giant step forward for their program. It's really the next thing for them to do under Stoops, get that signature win.
Yep.
But if you play like this on the road against a team like this, it's not going to happen.
Yeah, they've been their own worst enemy. I mean, just shooting themselves in the foot time and time again throughout that first 30 minutes.
We start with Leary under center and try to establish the run with Ray Davis. 5-yard gain for Davis. Fifth-year senior out of San Francisco.
Davis just didn't have a ton of opportunities in that first half, but was pretty efficient when he had his chances and averaged over 4 yards a carry. Just haven't been able to really get a whole lot going when they get behind the sticks because of penalties.
10 carries, 43 yards for Davis. Averaged 7.8 yards per carry coming in. Of course, when you run for 280 in a game, you're going to have some impressive averages. Chaz Chambliss, good coverage on the tight end Josh Caddis. It'll be third down and 5.
This is well defended as they try to just slip Caddis out into the flat. Of course, you got kind of an edge defender defensive end in Chaz Chambliss, but Ken drop, showing off some cover ability there.
Kentucky's 2 out of 7 on third down. They held Auburn to 2 out of 12 on third down in their victory in the loveliest village on the plains last week. Even with a passive rush, they still almost got to Leary. There is a flag down, a couple, in fact, in the offensive backfield as the pass was incomplete for Davis with Dumas Johnson in coverage.
Holding, offense, number 69, a penalty supplied, resulted play is fourth down.
Marcus Cox, the left tackle. They went out into the transfer portal, brought in 5 offensive linemen. The big blue wall had a lot of leaks last year. And Marcus Cox was a starter at Northern Illinois. Matter of fact, you have the 6 straight starts now for Kentucky. He has started 40 career games. Wilson Berry, the putter. Mekhi Muse got hit hard at the 39-yard line by Trevin Wallace. Here's Molly McGrath.
Well, when asked about his defense, Sean, head coach Mark Stoops said, "We haven't made a tackle yet." He was very frustrated. He said, "Give them credit. They're attacking us. We're just not responding well." So his message to his defense in the locker room was, regroup, get your eyes right, and you need to attack them back and play with physicality. Also, safety Jalen Geiger is out for the rest of the game with a left elbow injury. And wide receiver Marion Brown is now questionable to play in the rest of the game, Sean.
Yeah, why push him with a hamstring? An important game. Likely they're going to come from behind here.
Nothing too significant as he came off the field a little earlier in the game, but just such a veteran presence there in the middle. After having already lost Mims earlier in the year, having that guy that's been around for a while there in the middle certainly helps your young quarterback.
Dylan Fairchild, Tate Ratledge, the guards. They didn't have a great day at Auburn. On target, first down. Ra-Ra Thomas the catch. An 11-yard gain.
Just surgical. I mean, Kentucky's defensive backs, the corners in particular, have gotten behind. I mean, they've kind of gotten attacked deep a couple times, and now they're starting to play soft, and Carson Beck's just taking what the defense gives him. All those underneath throws and just piling up the completions.
This is three straight games with 300 yards passing for Beck, and he did it in a half tonight. Dejon Edwards, a short gain out of bounds inside the 40. You have to go back 10 years for the last time a Georgia quarterback threw for 300 in three straight games, Aaron Murray in 2013. And he's the fifth player now in the last two decades with 300 passing yards and a completion percentage of 80% or more in a half against a conference opponent. You want to guess on the other four?
Joe Burrow would be a safe guess, I would assume.
Tua Tagovailoa, Matt Corral, and this last one should be very easy.
Yeah.
Here's Dylan Bell. A yard short of the first down at the Kentucky 34. Greg McElroy threw for 300 plus and 80% in a first half against Auburn. Did the big game as well. 2010. They fake the run on third down and one. Receivers open everywhere. Flag down to the secondary. Marcus Rosemy Jack Saint the catch for a first down if it stands.
Looked like a pretty significant push off from Rosemy Jack Saint against Andrew Phillips, but there's a lot of separation back there as the offensive line continues to play extremely well in protection for Carson Beck.
Interesting play call as well from Mike Bobo.
Pass interference. Offense, number one, 15-yard penalty, third down.
Well, that might be why he was so wide open.
They had had success, obviously, third and one on a heavy play action earlier in the game and tried to go back to the well. And this time, it wasn't to be.
Takes down a 17-yard gain. Beck 24 out of 29 for 327, three touchdowns and no interceptions. Just a three-man rush for Kentucky. Into traffic and it's intercepted. Picked off by Maxwell Hairston. And with some running room along the near sideline. And chopped down by Beck. Inside the 30. 47-yard return. It's already the fourth interception of the year for Hairston.
And it's just not a good decision for Carson Beck. A play that they ran earlier in the game that resulted in a touchdown to Rosemy Jack Saint. That was the first touchdown of the game. This time he's trying to force it to love it on the over route. Throws it a little bit too high. It was well covered. And as a result, there's Hairston to reel it in.
Started the day fourth in the nation with three interceptions. Now he has four. He's already turned two for a touchdown this year. And that one brought back 47. Give a little life to the Wildcats. Ray Davis for two. And Davis, a transfer from Vanderbilt. He was in the transfer portal. He and Devin Leary had a mutual friend who connected the two. Devin Leary visited Kentucky, loved it. And he called Ray Davis and said, why don't you come with me? And they both committed on the same day. Leary said Liam Cohen said the fact that Leary was the quarterback was another reason why he wanted to come back to Kentucky. Wide open Davis. First down inside the 10. Touchdown Kentucky. Another great call by Liam Cohen and well executed by the Cats. 26 yards. And that is Davis's fourth receiving touchdown of the season. He can hurt you in the pass game as well.
And a great job too by Devin Leary. As you see those two Georgia defenders that are approaching, he has to kind of navigate between two defenders to make that throw. It seems easy, but it's actually quite difficult. He did so beautifully. And Ray Davis did the rest. What a tremendous play there for the Wildcat offense.
They're going for two. They put the ball on the left hash mark. Michael Williams came on late for Georgia, but they're lined up. Davis, the running back on the right hip, O'Leary. They direct snap it to Davis. Trying to surge toward the end zone. He got stacked up well short. Well, the interception is the only turnover of this game so far. And two plays later, it's Davis. 34-13 early. So history made by Ray Davis tonight with that touchdown. He's the first Wildcat ever with a score in each of the first six games of the season. And that's 12 touchdowns total, 8 rushing and now 4 receiving for Davis.
He's an elite back, man. It's been fun to watch him operate here in the first half of the season.
Wonder if they'll try to squib it, pooch it, hope for a mistake from Georgia. Still down by 21 points, 10 and a half to go, third quarter. They kick it down into the wind, caught on the run by Muse. Mekhi Muse came as a walk-on. He's been a dynamic kick returner. 22 yards there. Here's Molly.
Well, Sean, Kentucky running back Ray Davis possesses a strength and maturity that is rare. Growing up, his parents were incarcerated. He was in foster care and he was homeless by the time he was 12. But he told us he wouldn't change a thing about his past, saying, I wouldn't be here on this field today if it weren't for the obstacles I faced. Growing up, I always used to ask God, why? Why am I homeless? Why is this happening to me? And I finally replaced the why me with, I understand now. I understand the obstacles I faced were lessons, and now it's my responsibility to achieve my goals and give back.
He was taken in at age 15 by his guardians, Laura Banks and Greg Lee. And the great news is his dad has gotten his life together. Molly and the father and son have been reunited. And I know Ray's very proud of what his dad has done.
Yes. Yeah, Sean, and Ray really wants the emphasis to be on the fact that life is all about second chances, and he is really appreciative of his father turning his life around and being there for him.
Proud of each other. Carson Beck hands it off. Edwards powers for the first down. I know, Molly, Ray Davis also expressed to you gratitude, you know, just to still be alive at this point in his life. He saw a lot of rough things when he was a kid.
Yeah, Sean, a lot of people in college football talk about making it, but for Ray Davis, it was something else entirely.
Edwards brings the crowd to life with that spin move. 7-yard gain there.
Such a special story of Ray Davis and perseverance, and obviously to see it play out here at the highest levels of college football is just truly remarkable, and a guy that I think everyone will root for.
Second down and 3.
Georgia scored on all six possessions in the first half, turned it over here early in this half. Wow, the effort by Milton. Molly?
Yes, John, we talk about making it in terms of Ray Davis. He said not a lot of people where I come from have made it. And when I say made it, I mean just made it to the age of 18. To be able to make it off of the streets, achieve the simplest thing in life, which is just living. A lot of my closest friends are no longer alive or are incarcerated. I'm doing this for them. I don't want to take a moment of this for granted. And you can see his passion translates to the football field as well.
There have been some great stories written about him in recent weeks with his success. Milton, the ball carrier. Again, I would encourage people to go find them. And he went through an extraordinary amount. We've just kind of scratched the surface. He came east to go to prep school, got an opportunity to start his college career at Temple. Now he has a degree from Vanderbilt. And I think he's on his way to the NFL, don't you?
No, there's no doubt about it. He'll be playing on Sundays and probably be paid quite handsomely to do so. He's an excellent back.
Milton stopped short of the first down by De'Eric Jackson. More than midway through the third quarter now.
This drive, it's really been about Georgia. Just quarterback just threw an interception. Let's lean on the offensive line in the run game. They've been pretty quiet running the football tonight. Just 112 total yards, but Dejon Edwards has made the most of his opportunities, over 7 yards a carry.
Third down and very short. And Beck has the first down. I think we're seeing these last few weeks, Greg, what their formula is going to be on offense. Mike Bobo said it to us yesterday. You know, we're going to be a team that has to lean heavily on the pass.
And it's pretty good spot to be at when your quarterback's playing as well as he is. Obviously, excluding the interception on the last possession, he's been for the most part flawless tonight. And these receivers, a group that they had high expectations for coming into the year, they're really starting to materialize some of those expectations and productivity.
Ra-Ra Thomas and Dominic Lovett were the best receiver on it. Another SEC team last year, and they still have this guy. The tight end hasn't won the Heisman Trophy since 1949 when Leon Hart of Notre Dame did it. If this guy isn't at least in the top 10, it's a disgrace.
It is. I mean, it's just, he's absolutely ridiculous. I mean, if he's not in the top 3, it's almost a disgrace. I mean, it really is. The guy is just ridiculous. And can take over the game at a moment's notice. You see right there the yards after catch again.
Those are the total yards in the last 3 games, 111 and counting tonight. 10th career 100-yard receiving game. He's a junior from beautiful Napa, California. Dylan Bell made something out of nothing. Jordan Lovett finally knocked him out of bounds. Time-consuming drive with a 3-touchdown lead. They've had the ball for more than 5 minutes. They're about to run their 10th play.
And this is kind of the offense that I think a lot of people for Georgia might have anticipated. Hey, just lean on you, big-bodied offensive line. Be able to mix run pass. But, man, they are such a force with Carson Beck throwing the football that they're not going to abandon doing what they do well, but they still have this in their arsenal.
Stepping out of bounds.
Let's see if Bell stepped out earlier in the journey. Yeah, he's clearly out. Yeah, hard to imagine how that official right there missed that.
How about this, though, too? In an 8-day span, you called 2 baseball games in front of a capacity crowd at the Trop.
Let's not go back there. It was a lovely time. They're great people.
You, of course, get to experience some top 20 love between the hedges, and then we drop the puck on Tuesday, baby.
Can't wait.
It's the Stars' year. It's our year.
It is. You're for your Dallas Stars?
Yes.
And that you're not a bandwagon jumper last year because they went to the
Western Conference Final. Dejan Edwards, the ball carrier. Yeah, you are a hockey guy. You text me a lot during the hockey season.
Hockey, it's my favorite. Outside of football, it's my favorite sport. I just absolutely love it. I can't wait for Tuesday.
Well, you know, our slogan this year is to know hockey is to love hockey. And for those watching this who really haven't paid much attention to hockey, you know, we encourage you to give it a try. The game has never been better. Players are enormously talented. The speed of the game. Here's a direct snap to Brock Bowers on third down and five, and he got driven back after a short gain. There's his 17th career rush.
That was probably one of the shortest ones too, because I think he was averaging about 10 yards a carry.
Yeah, he had 16 career rushes for 172.
That's
coming into tonight.
Decent average, I'd say.
More than 10. When we talk about tight ends in the Heisman Trophy voting, here's Woodring trying to go 3 for 3 with a 32-yarder. Kyle Pitts of Florida finished 10th in the Heisman balloting in 2020. The only tight end in the top 10 in the voting since 1977, Ken McAfee. It's supposed to go to the best player in college football. A lot of great players, but he merits significant consideration. You're watching ESPN Saturday College Football Primetime, presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. Of the defending champion Aces in the finals for the third time in 4 years. It's 2:30 tomorrow with NBA Countdown, WNBA Countdown. Kickoff is a touchback. Georgia just held the ball for 7 minutes and 7 seconds. And the Dogs leading the Cats 37-13 with 3:27 to go in the third quarter.
If you're Kentucky, obviously this one's out of reach, more than likely. But man, every other game on your schedule is extremely winnable. So I think it's very important for Devin Leary and Leon Cohen to kind of create some momentum offensively here. I mean, the passing game has had some ups and downs. See if they can get their quarterback dialed in, because that'll pay major dividends down the road.
Here's Ray Davis. This is the third straight year Kentucky off to a great start. 6-0 in 2021, 4-0 last season, 5-0 coming into tonight. Five of the remaining seven starting tonight were against ranked teams. So that'll be four of the remaining six. See if Missouri stays in after losing today to LSU.
Can't imagine they will, but I would expect, I mean, they're going to be a favorite in probably four of those games, more than likely, depending on how things shake out.
And Leary's pass, hard to tell if that was tipped. That's been a problem, batted balls. Of course, you know, Mark Stoops admitted that the season's schedule was set up to kind of ease into it. They started with Ball State, Eastern Kentucky, Akron, and Vanderbilt. But after they beat Florida last week, 33-14, really dominated. That earned a lot of believers. They moved into the top 25 for the first time this year. Might be a short stay. This sellout crowd still fully engaged. 69 straight sellouts, and they love it. Jamon Dumas Johnson with his second sack.
And you're going to see the offensive line just not sort this thing out. Everybody's kind of sliding to the left, and as a result, Dumas Johnson could just attack the left guard, Dylan Ray. His eyes are to the right. He's got to kind of hang there just a little bit, knowing that that linebacker could very easily come from depth. Instead, he abandons his post. And next thing you know, Leary's dropped for a loss.
By the junior from Hyattsville, Maryland, he played at St. Francis Academy for Biff Poggi. When he started there, now the coach at Charlotte. In his first year as a head coach in college football, bad bounce on the Wilson Berry punt. Just a 22-yard boot. Well, Georgia, the long string of dominance, the school record 22 wins and counting. They've been national champions now for 635 days. They've been number one in the AP poll for almost a full year now. They weren't number one at the beginning of last season, even though they were the defending champs. the move to number one and stayed there. Doug 11 is awake a few minutes ago. Boom was taking a nap. They have a swearing in ceremony that took place at the spring game. They call it getting collared.
Really?
When you're officially the new and the latest in the long line of great Uggas, one of the great mascots in all of American sports.
I'd imagine he's got a pretty good life. I mean, just making a living off of filet mignon and things of that nature.
Like you, national championship winning quarterback. I think that is air conditioned.
Yeah. Oh, no question.
Although you don't need it tonight. It's actually a cool night. After a gorgeous day in one of the great college towns in America, and what a beautiful campus. Under a minute and a half to go in the third quarter. Deep ball and incomplete. Rosemary Jackson one-on-one with Hairston. Let's check in with Molly.
Well, Sean, I have some injury updates for you. Kentucky nose guard Keyshawn Silver is out, and linebacker Trevin Wallace is questionable to return. Both of them have shoulder injuries. And remember, their defensive coordinator Brad White said linebacker is a position where they don't have enough depth and experience. So that's concerning for the Wildcats.
Yeah, their starters are terrific. Weaver and Wallace and Jackson, excellent. Just not a lot of depth and experience behind them.
They are just not very deep, too, so any injuries to frontline players is a significant issue.
On third down and nine, Beck, quick throw, caught. Beautiful throw, threw it in the perfect place for Ra-Ra Thomas. 21 yards up to 368. For Carson Beck on 27 out of 34.
Then just perfect throw and a great job too by Ra-Ra Thomas. Look at him flip his hips, so natural. The ball's thrown in a perfect place to kind of throw Ra-Ra Thomas away from Hairston, who had decent coverage. But a great throw is going to beat great coverage every single time.
Fifth catch for Thomas for 63 and his first Georgia touchdown. Powers is wide open. Touchdown. 21 yards. His first touchdown reception of the night. And 24th of his career, he moves out of a tie for second. All time in Georgia with A.J. Green. Only Terrence Edwards with more. He had 30 touchdown receptions from 99 through 2002. 7 for 132 and a touchdown for Bowers, capping a four-play drive. And a career-high 4 touchdown throws for Carson Beck. Peyton Woodring, the extra point.
This is just great design by offensive coordinator Mike Bobo. He has the motion guy going out wide, which bumps this defender a little wide, which allows Bowers to just release vertical right up the seam. This is tremendously done. The middle field safety can't get over quick enough because of the play action. He's held for a half second. And Carson Beck gets the ball out so quickly and gets it on Bowers so quickly that the safety can't get over the top to recover. Just great throw and catch, but great design as well by Mike Bobo to create that matchup.
Bowers is the first Georgia player with 100 plus receiving yards in 3 straight games in the same season since Terrence Edwards back in 2002. And the other team is trying to stop him. You know, most of their focus is on taking him away, or much of it anyway.
Which is why you have to be so creative as an offensive coordinator to get the looks that you want, to be able to get him to the space in the zone where he can potentially exploit it. And like I said a moment ago, that was really nicely designed to bump that secondary defender out wide and hit him on the seam.
Jared Zirkel, another kickoff and another touchback. Bowers won the Mackey Award last year. First Georgia player to win that award, at the top tight end in the country. Very likely to win it again this season. He and Herschel Walker are the only Georgia Bulldogs to be All-Americans as freshmen and sophomores. That's not bad company.
About to say, only maybe the greatest college football player of all time being alongside him. I'd say that's It's a pretty nice decoration.
He's a junior, almost certainly in his final year of college football. Bowers from an athletic family. His parents were athletes at Utah State. His sister, a collegiate athlete. Ray Davis weaves his way ahead for about seven. And some of the backups getting in now for the Georgia defense was C.J. Madden, redshirt freshman, made his third tackle of the season, wearing number 16, a backup linebacker. And Kirby Smart said, hey, when we get three touchdowns ahead, the backups go in. They've earned the right to play. That's how they get experience. He has said that, you know, a lot of the statistical damage done in the first five games was against the backups. So we played very well when the first group's been in there, and that was the case again tonight. The end of the third quarter, Georgia leading Kentucky 44-13. Might as well be me.
Coach, what have you seen from your quarterback Carson Beck tonight?
Well, I don't know the numbers, but he's got great composure. He's in good rhythm. When he's in good rhythm, he's pretty good. But the running game has helped him.
Will we see him at all in the fourth quarter?
Who?
Will we see Carson Beck in the fourth quarter?
We haven't talked about it yet. We're talking about defense right now.
All right. Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
Well, the running game has helped a little. 119 yards rushing. Just enough to help the passing game. Ray Davis, the ball carrier, on second and two as the fourth quarter begins. And he got three. Tackled by Tyke Smith. Brock Vandegrift and Gunnar Stockton are the backup quarterbacks. And both have seen action already this season.
There was a hotly contested quarterback contest throughout the spring, but Carson Beck with an elite spring game kind of distanced himself from the field. But man, don't talk about quarterback depth. They have plenty of it here at Georgia.
Devin Leary batted down. Well played. Xavier Sorey. Intended for Kamari Anderson. Mark Stoops' team 2 out of 9 on third down. Hard to believe he's already the second longest tenured head coach in the SEC in his 11th year, behind only Nick Saban. And Stoops, the eighth longest tenured coach in his current position in the country. Ray Davis, the ball carrier.
Obviously, Mark Stoops has done an amazing job. As you see, some of the longest tenured coaches, Kirk Ferentz, my goodness, quarter century, Kyle Whittingham and Mike Gundy. Mark Stoops slowly rising up that list, and what a job he's done here at Kentucky, turning them into a consistent winner and a perennial thorn in the side of some of the best teams in the conference.
Trying to take the next step from good to great. Two 10-win seasons in the last 6 years. They were 10-3 in both 2018 and 2021. And that one's dropped by Tavion Robinson. It'll be fourth down and 8, and the punting team will come on. Georgia has not punted tonight.
11 is now number 27 for Georgia.
The same cannot be said of Wilson Berry. Punting for the seventh time. Muse signaling enthusiastically for the fair catch, and he made it while backpedaling at the 21. Georgia on its way to its 23rd straight victory. That was a 43-yard punt. Carson Beck is done for the night, or at least for the time being. And here's Brock Vandegrift, redshirt sophomore from Bogart, Georgia. In relief of Beck, playing in his fourth game of the year. UT Martin, Ball State, UAB, and now Kentucky. Dylan Bell with a short game. Davin Rainer made the tackle. So Beck, career high 389. In his third straight 300-yard plus game, four touchdowns, one interception, giving him 11 touchdown passes for the season and three picks.
Just a great performance all around. I mean, the one interception was a tough throw, tough coverage, just missed a little high. But other than that, man, I mean, there were very few throws that were off target tonight.
And to Griff, the handoff looked like it was juggled for a moment by Muse. Good night for Carson Beck. Terrific night, in fact.
About as good as you can possibly ask for. I mean, you start the game beautifully, complete your first 10 passes, including this one on a nice touch throw to Rosemary Jack Saint. And then on Ra-Ra Thomas in the front left corner. Really nice throw and a great design.
Muse scampers out to the 28-yard line. I'd imagine it's probably the end of the night for Bowers as well. So it'll be a three and out for the offense, engineered by Vandegrift, and the first punt of the night for Brett Forson. Both of these teams have Australian punters. He's from Melbourne, a sophomore. Second year as a starter. Took over for Jake Camarda. They have a long line of terrific putters. And he's another. Tavion Robinson, the fair catch of a 40-yard punt. Levin wants to go to the sideline now, congratulate the team on the big win.
Doesn't need a credential, I can assure you of that.
No.
I think you can probably just run out to the 50-yard line if you like.
Had a little bit of a nap earlier. So here's first and 10 for Kentucky. Just 166 total yards of offense. They had some good moments in the first half. Demi Sumo Karngbe, the ball carrier. Molly.
Sean, you know that a game has gotten away from you when one of the mascots, the live mascots, is making its rounds on the sidelines and all the players are so excited, petting Uga, or Boom as we know him, as he's making his rounds. In all the Georgia games we've done, I've never seen that before.
It's kind of like when the owner comes down at the end of the NFL game. wants to be seen. I did the game in 1996 when at Auburn, when Uga
tried to lunge.
Yeah, lunge at one of the Auburn players.
Oh, I've seen that picture a million times. You did that game?
I did that game for CBS. And I was talking about yesterday, Jim Donnan was the coach at Georgia, Hall of Fame, college football Hall of Famer, one of the all-time great guys. And I believe that was the first overtime game in SEC history. And Mike Bobo, now the offensive coordinator, played in that game.
Was he the quarterback?
Yeah, I think he had been benched.
Holding. Oh. Offense, number 75, 10-yard penalty, second down.
We won't talk about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, but I mean,
we won't bring it up anymore.
No, there was so much to that game. That was the first time I ever saw a coach, Coach Donnan, cover his mouth with the play sheet. And he told us that he had been tipped off that Auburn, brother Bill Oliver, the legendary defense coordinator, they had, you know, a bunch of guys up in the press box with binoculars trying to read the lips and get the play calls.
Yeah.
So, you know, Jim was the first coach I ever saw do that, and now obviously right. They all do it.
Yeah. That's wild.
Jim Donnan, still very close to the program, lives here in Athens. He's very close to Kirby Smart and Mike Bobo, both of whom played for him. What a great resource he is for this outstanding coach and his staff. He also does a watch along on, I believe, on YouTube. So people are watching the game with Coach Donnan and getting his insights. Jalen Walker in on the sack. Raylan Wilson also there, true freshman, getting some playing time. It's the third Bulldog sack.
This is so difficult as you see the left guard trying to pull out, take advantage of the edge presence of Walker, and he just doesn't have a chance. Walker beats him quickly with speed around the edge.
Walker's a sophomore from Salisbury, North Carolina. His dad was his high school coach, Curtis.
the former defensive coordinator in college at Coastal Carolina. Flags down. Muse electrifying those who are still between the hedges and in the stands. But it might be coming back. There's a flag way back at the 17-yard line. ...57-yard punt, 64-yard return that might get wiped out. News has already brought one back for a touchdown, 69 yards in the... ...early season against Ball State.
During the return, illegal block in the bag, return team, number 27, half the distance to the goal. First down.
There's the block. That wipes out that big return. 9:16 to go here in Athens. And back here in Athens, Brock Vandegrift on for his second series. Hands it off to Cash Jones, the former walk-on. He got chopped down shy of the 30 by Zion Childress. Good for 19. Great name, isn't it? Cash Jones.
Love that.
Actual first name's Cashin, which is his mom's maiden name. He's becoming an important player. He's arrived here about 165 pounds. He's up to 182. Also claims he's the best golfer on the team.
Really?
Yeah. Zach Rapatrazone, our spotter, claims he is the best golfer in our group.
Well,
I'm not sure.
Would be more than willing to put that to the test.
Yeah, Scott Johnson, our director, before he had his boo-boo on his knee, but now here's Vandegrift taking off and running out near midfield. Brock out of Prince Avenue Christian School in Georgia. We played for his dad, Greg. Like so many of these Georgia players, very highly recruited. He was the National High School Quarterback of the Year in 2020 by the National Quarterback Club.
He's going to be good, too. He's got a little bit more mobility than Carson Beck, a good runner, but is improving significantly with his accuracy as well.
Andrew Paul is in at running back number 3. That's off the hands of Lawson Lucky. They think is going to be a tremendous tight end, true freshman from Norcross, Georgia. He's been a little banged up lately. Well, here are the streaks that are about to be extended. It'll be their 23rd straight win overall, their 23rd consecutive home win, their 16th in a row against the SEC East, and their 14th against Kentucky. Their last loss in any game was in the SEC championship game in December of 2021 to Alabama. So they started the winning streak. That's Andrew Paul, the redshirt freshman from Dallas. They started the winning streak in the 2021 college football playoff semifinal against Michigan in the Orange Bowl. And that 22-game winning streak is the school record. It'll be 23.
I know it kind of gets taken for granted because of how good they are, but in 23 consecutive games against some of the teams that they've played is just absolutely ridiculous.
And it'll be the fourth longest winning streak ever by an SEC team, tying Tennessee from back in the late 30s. We got some intel on that team from our statistician Mike Swanson, who worked some of those Vols games in the late 30s. The longest winning streak ever by any SEC team is Alabama. 28 in a row. They did it twice in the late 70s and again in the early 90s. These records could easily be broken by this juggernaut. This will be their 22nd straight regular season SEC win. Dating back to 2020. Vandegrift fires, showing off his arm on target to the 20-yard line to Pierce Sperlin, the third, another tight end.
They seem to have an abundance of talented tight ends. 25 yards.
And that was a nice throw there by Vandegrift. Little back shoulder to Sperlin. Would love to have kept him upright so he could continue his forward momentum, but still a good completion after staying on the sidelines for 3.5 quarters.
10 different receivers have caught a pass now tonight for Georgia. They have 588 yards of total offense. Savon Clark, the ball carrier. Tyrese Fearbree, the backup linebacker, stopped it for a loss of one. So Georgia's at Vanderbilt. Then they have the rivalry game with Florida. Missouri and Ole Miss come here. They go to Tennessee and they finish out of the conference with their traditional game against Georgia Tech.
And obviously that Missouri game is one that's likely to be circled, knowing just how close that one was last year. Now having the opportunity for some revenge. Florida feels like they're coming back to earth the last couple weeks, even though they had a nice win today. And Tennessee, they're a real big question mark right now. And I'm just not really sure how to feel about them at the moment.
Vandegrift wants Lucky to block for him. He got chopped down right at the first down marker by Ty Bryant, a true freshman out of Lexington. His dad played at Kentucky. Cisco Bryant, a good wide receiver for Jerry Claiborne back in the 80s.
That right there is a big hit. A good teachable moment for Brock Vandegrift. Man, if you're going to go out of bounds, go out of bounds. Don't try to tightrope the sideline when there's an SEC defender just waiting to knock you out.
32 first downs for Georgia to 11 for Kentucky. First and goal, and Paul dragged down for no gain.
Andrew Paul on the carry.
So this will be 33 straight regular season wins for Georgia. That started in 2020. Their last regular season loss was to Florida, November 7th of 2020 in Jacksonville, 44-28. It was also their last regular season SEC loss. With this win, they'll be 35-1 overall in their last 36 games. The premier program in college football, without a doubt. Vandegrift, juggling attempt by Anthony Evans the third. Looks like they're going to give him the catch with Ty Bryant there. Tonight on the SEC Network, the Football Final Crew will take you through the biggest stories of the day. Break down all the games immediately after the Arkansas-Ole Miss matchup over in the SEC Network and the ESPN app. Vandegrift looks to the sideline. Got into three games last year. And got a couple of series back in 2021 against Charleston Southern. All kinds of time, and he nearly threw an interception. Davin Rayner, frustrated he couldn't take that in. He's another transfer for Kentucky from Northern Illinois.
This was really close. Vandegrift trying to work his tight end in the back of the end zone, and Rayner reaches up and almost pulls it in.
Pierce Berlin put his hands up to his helmet. He realized that that got through. He had his first career touchdown catch. He's a true freshman. Fourth and goal, they're going for it from the eight. Vandegrift's 4 out of 6 for 39 since coming in for Beck. Andrew Paul to the pylon, touchdown. J.Q. Hardaway couldn't stop him. And Georgia's put up 50 tonight against a usually very stout Kentucky defense.
Just a great job. You see Vandegrift didn't like anything downfield, gets it to his outlet. And Paul obviously does the dirty work to find pay dirt as you take a look at the progressive pylon cam, which got mowed over right there on the side as Kirby Smart looks on, very happy with his backup offense and putting some more points on the board.
This is how you get better and build depth. Guys like Andrew Paul getting considerable playing time late, his first career touchdown. And Woodring on for the extra point. It's about as straight down the middle as it could be. 2:38 to go. Georgia up 51-13. In the history of the rivalry, 123 years, they'll both be in the top 10 when facing each other. Two powerhouse offensive teams. Game day will be there in beautiful Seattle along the shores of Lake Washington. That will be a lot of fun. I'll tell you what, the Pac-12's going out with a bang, isn't it?
Man, are they ever.
Having a terrific year. And a big hit on the kickoff return. It was Anthony Brown Stevens who brought it out, and he got rocked by Roderick Robinson. So there are some Pac-12 Heisman contenders, including the two quarterbacks you'll see in that Oregon-Washington game next week. Do you have a Heisman front runner right now?
I do. Penix would be my front runner at the moment. He's been just electric for Washington so far, and just watching the way he places the football, it's just been remarkable. So if I were to give it out right now and to put names on the ballot, it'd probably be some combination of Michael Penix, Caleb Williams, and Brock Bowers.
Jaton McClain, the ball carrier. Kyer Sharon is on at quarterback. Terrell Foster made the tackle. Both coaches emptying the benches here for the most part as we approach 2:15 to go. And there's still more action tonight. You saw Caleb Williams, the reigning Heisman Trophy winner, 21 touchdowns, one interception.
Yeah.
USC in the top 10. Along with Oregon and Washington, they're taking on an improving Arizona team coming up shortly. Jaton McClain again. Ray Davis done for the night. 15 for 59 for Davis after his 280 last week, which was 19 yards shy of the single game school record for Kentucky.
Obviously, Kentucky's got a lot of football left this season, and Ray Davis, I think, is going to be a huge part of their continued upward trajectory, man. I mean, these teams, obviously, they've cracked double-digit wins a few times. They can possibly get there this year as well if he continues playing the way he's playing.
They have been totally dominated in this rivalry. This is the 77th meeting.
Timeout. Kentucky, their first of the half.
Georgia will now have a 63-12-2 all-time advantage with 14 straight wins. So Georgia's winning streak right now in this rivalry of 14 is more wins than Kentucky's had in the history of the rivalry all time.
Yeah, I mean, it's a tough matchup for Kentucky. I mean, to be honest with you, they're kind of built in the same framework as Georgia, a team that just wants to absolutely beat you up, deliver body blow after body blow after body blow. So to out Georgia, Georgia is a very difficult thing to do. They had plenty of opportunities early, though, to make it interesting and to apply some pressure, and they just can't have self-inflicted mistakes. I mean, that was really the storyline of the first half and why this thing got totally out of hand.
Trying to avoid what happened last year when they started 4-0, went to Ole Miss and lost, wound up 7-6. With Will Levis at quarterback, who was a second-round draft pick, they lost to Iowa in the Music City Bowl last year. I don't think that's going to happen. I think the offensive line is better. I mean, they had an excellent running back last year, Chris Rodriguez,
right,
who's in the NFL with Washington, but Davis might be even better.
The schedule is tougher, though, in fairness. I mean, obviously getting Alabama out of the West is really difficult, naturally, as one of your crossovers. Tennessee's pretty good. Louisville looking like they're en route to becoming 6-0. So it's a very difficult schedule.
Saw Kamari Anderson on the ground. And And Devin Leary, you know, they were hoping maybe tonight was the night he'd be more in sync with the receivers, more accurate. It didn't happen. You wonder if there's just lingering after effect from the torn pec surgery. He says he's fine, but he's just not what he was at NC State.
Yeah, and you talk to Liam Cohen, his offensive coordinator. I mean, some of it's a comfort thing. There are concepts where he looks really decisive, and those are concepts that he's familiar with that he ran at NC State. But some of the newer things, he's kind of struggled to grasp, and I think he's going to have to play really, really well down the stretch if they're going to accomplish the things they want to accomplish.
I think the next step is really to be a realistic contender to win the East. Georgia continues to dominate their East opponents. They'll go to 38-5 against the East under Kirby Smart. Jonathan Jefferson, 51 points for Georgia, season high.
The defensive player qualifies for a 10-second runoff. Please reset the game clock.
I just hate seeing these injuries at the end of the game. I mean, just trying to get out of there, get back on the bus, address some things. Man, I feel terrible for these guys that are a little beat up these last couple snaps.
And you know they're excited to play because a lot of these guys are third or fourth stringers who are getting the opportunity. Jefferson walks off. So Georgia 3-0 in conference, and Kentucky joins Florida, Missouri, Tennessee as the one-loss teams in the East. And the officials are running off the field. I think they're just going to let the clock expire here. And it's ball game over. So the records continue. 23 straight wins, the school record. 23 straight regular season wins, also the school record. 22 regular season SEC wins is one shy of their school record. They've now won 23 straight at home, one shy of the record set by the great Herschel Walker teams back in the early 80s. Came on the air saying there's the perception that this team is not as good as the previous two, but they're trying to smash that belief, and that guy with Molly's a big reason why they might be. Molly?
Carson, you threw for 389 yards and four touchdowns. You just look surprised when I told you that. How are you able to find so much success in the passing game tonight?
I mean, early on, it felt like nothing could go wrong. You know, we were completing the ball everywhere. Guys were making plays. Good yards after the catch. I felt like I was holding the ball back there forever. We had great protection. I didn't know how many yards I had, so he just told me, but that's cool.
You talked about that strong start. You completed your first 12 passes of this game. What does it feel like to get into a rhythm like that?
I mean, one of our things that we've been trying to get after is to like have a strong start, and obviously we haven't had one, and it's been a huge emphasis for us. So, you know, just tried to approach the game a little bit differently coming into it, and try to have that energy coming out in the first quarter, in the first half. So, to be able to have that type of success early was really good for the team.
You told us your confidence grows every single game. Where's your confidence at right now?
I feel like it's in a good place, and it's just going to continue to improve each game. Obviously, we'll go back and watch the film. Obviously, nothing's perfect. I had to pick too, so just go back, learn, and then continue to improve each game.
Kirby Smart told us this team still doesn't know their identity yet. You guys are still figuring it out. Well, what did you learn about this team tonight in this dominant win?
That we're going to compete no matter what. It's always about us. We're going to go out there. We're going to be physical. We're going to have composure when things aren't going our way. And at the end of the day, we're just going to try to get a win.
All right. Congrats on the win tonight.
Thank you so much.
Sean.
He started the night as the only FBS quarterback who had had 60% completion percentage or better, 20 completions and 250 passing yards in every game this season. And he did that again tonight. Maybe we should get his name up on some of those Heisman graphics.
He's on his way.
Big night all the way around for Molly McGrath, Greg McElroy, and our great crew. Sean McDonough saying so long from Athens. Georgia wins 51-13. Here's the studio.